Welcome to Act and Unwind, an ongoing conversation on a free and virtuous society. I'm your host, Eric Cohn. I want to thank you for listening, and I want to ask that if you're listening to us on our website, that you navigate right now to the show notes for this episode, where you're going to find a link to subscribe directly to Act and Unwind at Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, or anywhere else where fine podcast products are found. And if you like this program, please leave us a 5-star review at Apple Podcasts so as to help more people find this show. This week, I'm joined by Sam Gregg, Acton's Director of Research, and Dan Huger, Librarian and Research Associate here at Acton. Today, we'll unmask the not-so-mystery of the rapid collapse of the transportation mask mandate, as well as what is happening with COVID zero policy lockdowns in Shanghai. And we're going to go to Disney World, but before we do that, I want to do a couple quick hits here at the beginning of things we've talked about on recent episodes that have developments today. The first of which, Sam and I, we talked about the French elections a couple weeks ago when we got to through the first round and knew we would have a runoff between Emmanuel Macron and Marine Le Pen. The results now in on that election. Macron winning 58.5% of the vote to Le Pen's 41.5%. Compare that to the 2017 presidential election, once again between Macron and Le Pen. Macron won 66% of the vote that year. So up to up from 33, almost 34% for Le Pen to over 41%. Sam, what do you make of that? Is this a sign of a surge in support for Marine Le Pen or more about dissatisfaction with Macron?
Well, I think it reflects many things. I think maybe the most important thing for all of us to get our minds around is that with a 41.5% vote, Marine Le Pen has won a greater share of the electorate than any far-right presidential candidate in France's post-Second World War era. So, in other words, what was once a fringe constituency in French politics is now one of the two major forces in French politics. Now, that's happened partly because Marine Le Pen has shifted the national rally, as it's called, or was once called the National Front, away from the anti-Semitism of her father, away from some of the more outlandish positions once held by the National Front, and has moved effectively to adopt a fair number of more center-right positions, while at the same time maintaining positions that the National Rally has always held, particularly on subjects like immigration, for example. But what's also important about that is that's also where a lot of the French electorate has shifted as well. So she has adapted her movement to the French electorate, but also a big chunk of the French electorate has moved in her direction on some particular issues. So that means the National Rally is now one of the major political forces in France that it wasn't only, well, really 5-10 years ago. So that's a significant change. It also means that many people voted for Macron, including quite a number of people on the far left, not because they like Macron, but because they did not want to vote for Marine Le Pen. So she has cobbled together a much broader coalition of middle and working class voters who live outside places like Paris, where wages are stagnant, where cost of living is going up. And some of these people include what you might call traditional conservatives, but even some people on the left who have been attracted to Marine Le Pen and her movement by her constant criticism of the economic and cultural elite, that of France, that Emmanuel Macron personifies. So Macron is going to have some significant challenges. He's going to need to try and get a majority in the National Assembly. And there's a lot of people who voted for him who will not vote for his party in the elections for the National Assembly. Which means he's going to have a great deal of difficulty getting through legislation that he wants to see passed. He's no longer Jupiter. He's been reduced, so to speak, to being more of a catch-all politician like most French politicians. And I think what this means is in 5 years' time, depending on what happens with what Marine Le Pen and her movement more generally, the direction they choose to go, we're seeing cemented in place some major changes in French politics that are not going to go away. So that's the broad takeaway I would have of this result.
Yes, I saw an excerpt last night from an exit poll, and everybody take exit polls with a grain of salt. But I believe the number I saw was that people asked whether they were voting for Macron or against Marine Le Pen. And the number was as high as like 90-something% of people.
Precisely.
Maybe that's an exaggeration. But nonetheless, Sam's point that this seems to be a manifestation of opposition to Le Pen rather than a support of any meaningful kind for Macron does seem obvious. Although, I hate these kinds of comparisons, and we had a lot of them that happened with Brexit and with other elections where we tend to overfocus and overinterpret it through the lens of American politics. But I just want to make the note that you wonder when you see, as Sam pointed out, how much consolidation of a base of support Le Pen has been able to make. You know, people will point out that Donald Trump was the most unpopular candidate in the history of the Gallup poll. Well, he ran against the second most unpopular candidate in the history of the Gallup poll. And you wonder how long this kind of thing is sustainable, that you don't get whoever the opposition candidate to Le Pen may be in an election 5 years from now is so disliked that it opens up that same Trump possibility for a shock victory for someone like Le Pen. Maybe it's not likely, but it certainly seems to be not implausible at this point.
In fact, Eric, to add on to that, Macron's popularity ratings still remain incredibly low. He's in the low 30s when it comes to popularity. So I think this speaks to your broader point about how negative politics has become in so many countries. People increasingly vote not what they're for, but what they're against. And you have to wonder how long that's sustainable.
The other interesting thing, and Sam is right, that Marine Le Pen has presided over sort of the legitimization in many ways of her party, has moderated considerably from her father. But what has remained constant is the Le Pens have been the flag bearers of this movement and have been the most popular. What we've never seen is a large presence of these sorts of parties in the National Assembly. What we've seen there, Macron has been able to sort of carve out a constituency in the center, many defectors from both the established center-left and center-right parties came into his movement. They have a substantial, the leading presence in the National Assembly. We haven't seen National Rally be able to do that yet. So I will be watching with interest the next National Assembly elections to see if this is something where, you have this isolated charismatic leader that, is obviously, not well-liked by a substantial majority of French folks, but has a substantial constituency. Can she translate that constituency into a constituency for her party and the broader political movement there?
Let's move on to our second quick hit topic here at the beginning. Again, updating topics that we've talked about recently. The news this morning, Monday morning, is that Twitter is going to accept Elon Musk's offer of evaluation of around $43 billion in his bid to acquire Twitter. Again, a share price of $54.20. Elon Musk, nothing if not humorous. So let's tackle this question this way. Dan, scale of 1 to 10, a year from now, and let's assume this deal does not fall apart at the last minute, Elon Musk acquires Twitter. Are conversations about Twitter and culture of free speech issues that exist around it and also emerging from it? So not just a question, not just for very online evaluation here, but the actual tenor of the conversation about the culture of free speech. A scale of 1 to 10, a year from now, 5, it's exactly the same. 10, it has changed infinitely for the better. And 1, it has changed infinitely for the worse.
I think it remains largely the same. Musk is trying to solve a problem on a particular platform, and he is a person who has immense resources to attempt to do so. But again, this is the smallest of the social media giants. And even this was met with very stiff resistance. I think we'll see some changes in Twitter's moderation policies. I think, though, that he's going to find out exactly how challenging that is. There is a lot to supervise, and there are some very sort of egregious things that happen online that need to be supervised. But I'd hope we'd see a more of a rules-based system instituted. I think one of the other things we're going to see is a lot of experimentation with the platform itself, with different features being introduced, with those sorts of things. Musk is somebody who has been committed to that sort of like technical nuts and bolts tinkering. You can see this in Tesla. You can see this in SpaceX, some of these other projects that he's been involved in. So, but I don't think the overall conversation is going to change. And I think, in fact, in the wake of his acquisition, you're going to get that conversation intensifying, particularly from journalists who are not too keen on this acquisition in general, and more left-wing people in particular. A lot of the folks who have been upset with current moderating principles or lack thereof have been from the right. I think you are going to see increasing anxiety about that sort of thing now on the left.
Sam, scale of 1 to 10 a year from now, how are the culture of free speech conversations surrounding Twitter? Are they 5 exactly the same, 10 infinitely better, or 1 infinitely worse?
I'm inclined to say somewhere between 6 and 7, and mainly for some of the reasons that Dan just suggested. Elon Musk is by no means a conservative. People should understand that. He's not a conservative. He's a curious melange of positions which aren't all completely coherent or fit well together. But if he's able to introduce or insist upon certain changes in the way that Twitter operates, whether it's things ranging from an edit button, which I personally think would be great, to the whole business by which the way in which Twitter goes about fact-checking, etc., if he's able to introduce some of those things, then I think you might find that Twitter becomes, at least in the eyes of some people, less of a place in which left-wing censorship is more or less the de facto underlying position that drives a lot of things that Twitter engages in. Witness Hunter Biden affair is, of course, the most notorious, right? So I think we'll probably see some changes there. But, you know, the people working at Twitter, I mean, I don't know if he's going to have lots of people leaving and going working for other outfits. I don't know if he's going to bring in his own people who will introduce some particular changes. And I think if it continues along the lines that it presently has with some of these modifications, then we'll see some changes, but not as many as some people think. But one thing I do think is important is that someone like Elon Musk buying Twitter is going to do a lot more to change Twitter than any amount of antitrust action that some conservatives have been talking about for the past couple of years. If this goes ahead in the way that many people envisage, Elon Musk will achieve so much more for freedom of speech on the internet than any amount of clumsy antitrust weaponization that I think would be very dangerous for the way that we understand what antitrust is for and the way it operates.
Yeah, I'm at a 5 leaning towards a 6. I think there is a chance for some mild improvement in some of these things. I agree if he were to adopt a moderation policy that basically mirrors the First Amendment and jurisprudence around the First Amendment, I think that that would be an improvement. I think it is just inevitable. I think it was inevitable for Twitter anyway that Donald Trump is going to end up being back on it, which ironically is going to be very, very bad for Donald Trump himself.
Right.
But I think that that is probably something – I think that was coming inevitably, especially if he decides he's going to run for president in 2024. It would be very difficult to have Donald Trump not on there. And then, of course, the obvious examples of the Ayatollah Khomeini is on there, but a former president of the United States is not. I don't know how sustainable that was actually going to be. But I just look at this as an absolute win-win. It's if Musk acquires it and it gets better, fantastic. I mean, he made something that is obnoxious and the importance of which is overvalued by almost everyone. Is better, fantastic. Or it is no change or it gets worse, and that was the current trend anyway. So I really don't see the downside here. And I think a large number of people who, if this deal goes through, are going to performatively leave Twitter, I give them about a week or two before they're back on it again because they're going to need their fix. And this is why the overreaction to it within media circles is so dramatic, because here is Elon Musk coming in and buying up their own public water cooler where all the important elites sit around and have these conversations with each other. So I think there will be a lot more freaking out about it than it actually will be warranted at the end of the day. But I agree with Dan that Elon Musk, in a way, I don't know if he knows what he's actually in for when Twitter is under his leadership. Again, assuming this deal goes through, will have to make difficult moderation choices, and they will have to make them at some point. Let's move on now to... Well, let's head down to Disney World, and I want to catch you up on what has gotten us here with this story that really came to a head over the weekend of legislation being passed and either has been signed or will be signed by Florida Governor Ron DeSantis to strip Disney of the Reedy Creek Improvement District, which is the special district that allows them to control almost everything about the land on which Disney World sits. So how did we get here? This started with Florida passing the Parental Rights in Education bill, known to its opponents as the Don't Say Gay piece of legislation, having to do with instruction on sex and gender in public schools, in K-12 public schools. We've talked about this already. I have some issues with the way that I think this legislation is broadly written. But nonetheless, we've also talked about how Disney had come out and said they were promising to work for the repeal of the legislation, but they only announced this after it had been signed into law, probably responding to internal pressures from some Disney employees that they get involved in all of this. There's the leak through Christopher Rufo of these internal all-hands conversation videos where you have people in the Disney content creation stream who are talking about how they will include various kinds of queerness in the program and the casting decisions and into the storylines. And in reaction to Disney asserting itself in this way, in opposition to this legislation that had already been passed and was already becoming law, Ron DeSantis, the governor of Florida and the Florida Republican Party, have decided to pass this piece of legislation that would strip Disney of this Reedy Creek Improvement District. It is one of, I should note, at least 1,200 such districts in Florida. The legislation on its face is probably written in a neutral enough sounding way because they put a date on districts that were formed before this state of the, I believe, the ratification of the new Florida Constitution, which just so happens to include Disney and a couple of others, that it would end a year from now. So I believe June 1 of 2023 is when this would go away. There will certainly be a legal challenge to this. The fact that it seems to be done out of spite seems to suggest that there could be legal recourse for Disney here. But we don't know that at this point, but we do know that it is now on a trajectory to have this district removed. Sam, what do you make of this action following the passage of the Parental Rights in Education bill to then turn around and stick it to Disney because Disney came out in opposition of it?
Well, if I were a Disney shareholder, I would be very angry with the CEO of Disney. Let's remember when this legislation, the original legislation you're talking about, was first proposed about, you know, what's talked about to children in school, et cetera, about questions of sexuality. Disney's CEO said, well, we're not going to get involved with this. This is something that needs to play out. And then, of course, he caved. He caved to activists within his own company. And instead of telling them, I'm sorry, but I'm the CEO, and this is what we're going to do. We're not going to be in the business of engaging in these sort of woke culture wars. We're not going to go down that path. He caved. And then, of course, state legislators reacted in the way that they have. And I agree with you. I think there's a lot of things that are problematic about the way that the Florida legislature has reacted and what this means for the what this means for Disney, what this means for questions of free speech, what this means for the whole business of political tit for tat, which increasingly is characterizing so much of American politics. But if I was a CEO who had presided over a 30% decline in share value, I would be expected to resign. So I have very little sympathy for Disney in this regard because they have brought this upon themselves. And it's about time that a lot of woke corporations started to realize that if they get into these games, if they get into these games and start trying to engage in these sorts of cultural enterprises, then they're going to pay a price. Now, I happen to think that the way that this is being played out is not very good. There's all sorts of problems with the way that, as I said, the Florida legislature and Governor DeSantis, I think, are acting in this regard. But CEOs need to realize that if you're going to conduct business throughout the entire United States, if you try and impose particular cultural values, which it is very clear, as you said, Eric, we know that employees in Disney have been trying to push gender ideology in this very insidious way upon all sorts of people who are watching Disney with no expectation that they're going to be exposed to very charged, very controversial questions about culture and sexuality. If corporate America doesn't understand that if you play these sorts of games, you will pay a price, then they're going to find themselves in all sorts of problems because they're going to start losing conservative and free market allies on the policy issues that really should matter for the bottom line of companies like regulation, trade, labor law, taxation, etc. If you have one side of the American body politic taking a deeply hostile view towards you, then that is not good for the ability of corporate America to try and pursue what is its bottom line, which is the pursuit and realization of economic value for its customers and its shareholders. And its job is not to get into these corporate, these woke agendas that I think are now starting to really hurt corporate America. The other thing I will also say, you mentioned the fact that this legislation will end effectively this corporate carve out that the Disney Corporation has in Florida. You know, if you live by the corporate carve-out, you die by the corporate carve-out. I would prefer that we didn't have any of these corporate carve-outs because they're basically a classic example of a type of cronyism. I would prefer that we didn't have any of these sorts of things. But companies should be aware that when you enter into these arrangements, there's always the possibility that a different governor or a different legislature or a different Congress will take that away and leave you with some major problems.
So I'm going to push back a little bit on Sam's last point there, that the nature of this is a corporate carve out or of cronyism, because I think we should, as Milton Friedman admonished us, to judge things by the impact, policies by the impact that they have, not by the intentions that were behind them. And this Reedy Creek Improvement District, and again, there, like I said, there are 1900 some similar districts like this in the state of Florida. Orlando International Airport is under one of these kinds of districts. And I think in this case, it actually was a net benefit for taxpayers and for looking at this from a libertarian-minded economic point of view, I actually think a pretty good example of the privatization of a lot of otherwise government functions. So you had essentially Disney being able to run the land that Walt Disney World sits on like it's its own city. So they're providing pest abatement, they're providing garbage services, they're providing their own fire department, they're providing their own security. Basically, I think, as I mentioned the last time we talked about this, the only thing that the counties take care of or the state takes care of is elevator inspections. It is very minimal. And for one of the arguments for this is the permitting process for the kinds of things that Disney would want to build would be very complicated for Orange and Osceola counties to be able to handle because they're uncommon. They're very bizarre in a way that is just not like building a corporate office park and the permitting that would come with that. So essentially what exists in this district is that Disney is paying itself taxes to be able to run all of these functions that I just enumerated and to run them privately. The impact of this is not so much to end a corporate tax benefit for Disney. And again, in fact, they were paying something on the order of $163 million per year towards the provision of these services. It is going to shift that tax burden to the taxpayers of Orange and Osceola counties, as well as about $1 billion of bond debt that Disney has. So the impact of this is actually going to put considerable costs onto the taxpayers of these counties. And again, this is where I have to come back to what really drives me crazy about this, is that it was done out of retribution. It was done to exact revenge on Disney for participating in the process. And I think to what Sam talked about at the beginning, there could be potentially the good knock-on effect of something that I don't like and I don't think is good to be endorsing, this kind of political punishment of corporate speech. And I think there certainly are some people who are in this, not because they want what I think may be the good knock-on effect of getting these corporations like Disney to just be silent on this stuff, you know, to borrow a phrase, to shut up and make cartoons, or, you know, other corporations getting them out of the kind of I didn't get a harumph from you in this social justice moment kind of placating that they do that Sam illustrated there. But I can acknowledge that that would be a good outcome. And again, that I think some of the people who are very animated about this would actually prefer the opposite, that Disney were inculcating and operating on values that they believe in, that they don't want them to just be quiet and neutral and outside of all of this. But I can still think that the process is pretty loathsome in terms of how it got there. Again, assuming that knock-on effect actually comes to reality.
Well, and this is something that the courts are going to have to work out. You know, there's the famous episode of Seinfeld where Jerry returns a jacket and they ask him why he would like to return the jacket. And he said that I would like to return it out of spite. And they said, well, you know, spite is not included in our return policy. And, you know, I'm of divided minds. I think there's interesting experiments in private governance in these sort of institutions in Florida that I think Eric is right to find some value in. There's also ways in which, you know, these things are politically established. And these are things that, you know, it is not as if I am out like a homeowner, you know, in Pensacola, I can submit a petition to the state to create my, you know, Huger Family Improvement District, and they will approve it, and I will be able to do the sort of things in my home in terms of, you know, what sort of electricians I'm able to use, what sort of permits I'm able to abide by, or I'm able to do. But there are real implications in terms of tax and regulation, and particularly the debt. Like, these things exist now, and they have incurred liabilities that someone is going to have to be responsible for in the future if they're dissolved. And it is very tricky. I mean, you have this in cities. I mean, Florida is very unique in the scope of some of these, and some of this has to do with, you know, these categories were created because Disney was making the sort of investments in in Central Florida that they were making at the time. But you have this in cities around the world with special economic development zones within cities where all of a sudden, you know, let's say you don't have a tax liability for the first 5 years. And, you know, these things are not wholly unconnected to where developers have made investments and then they lobby for, why is, 60% of the property owned in this newly declared, tax haven? Like, you know, that doesn't happen by accident. So I agree with Sam that these sorts of things are troubling from a rule of law perspective if they are not equally open to all, and if there's not a rules-based, there might be all sorts of reasons for these sort of private governance models, and they may be advantageous, but the process by which people are able to enter into them needs to be rule-based. It needs to be an open market for these things, and it needs to not be connected to the political cronyism, which, you know, politicians can and will act out of spite. It will happen, and it has happened here. And now this is something that not only Disney has to deal with, but Orange and Osceola County as well.
The only thing I'd add to that is that, I mean, I tend to think about these things in terms of general rules as well. General rules are far more preferable to these type of very specific carve-outs that are being suggested. So it's one thing to have these things happen under a sort of general rule format that Dan is proposing. I think that's actually a good idea. But when it comes to the way that these things are done in America today, they're classic examples of cronyism. And free marketers should be very much paying attention to that and saying, this is not how these things should be developing. The second thing is I hope the Disney Corporation, a lot of other corporations, will go back and say, okay, maybe we need to do something which is called, what is the fundamental purpose of a business? And Milton Friedman gave a very good summary of what that was in his famous article on this particular subject that was published in the New York Times almost 40 years ago, that their business is to provide services and goods for consumers and to provide shareholder value. And they need to stop getting involved in subjects where they're simply not competent to talk about because they end up damaging and undermining what is, in fact, their telos. They should be free to say what they think. Obviously, that's true. But they should understand that when you start to depart from what is your governing telos of what Aristotle called the fundamental purpose of an organization, you start to get yourself in trouble. It's the same for religious organizations that talk about economic questions that they're simply not competent or able to talk about. So, I mean, this is the whole problem with woke capitalism. It's now starting to undermine the correct perception of what is the purpose of business, which leads you into these types of situations. In corporate America, particularly CEOs, need to be turning around to their employees and saying, we're here to do this. If you want to be a political activist, go join a political party.
Dan, I was reminded of your piece, the cover story in the most recent edition of Religion and Liberty, what I saw at the National Conservatism Conference, when I saw a tweet about this story from one Josh Hammer, who you talk about in that piece. And this message from Mr. Hammer was in response to Charles C.W. Cook, who has been writing quite eloquently at National Review about why he opposes this action by DeSantis and Florida Republicans. Hammer's reply to Charles Cook was that, on the contrary to Cook's points, this is a perfect example of the kind of fighting right right now required, a right, that is, which is willing to wield political power in muscular fashion to reward friends and punish enemies within the confines of the rule of law. I love the within the confines of the rule of law caveat that is thrown onto the end of that, the kind of thing I am very convinced he would be willing to drop when the desire to reward friends and punish enemies runs headlong into the rule of law. And here's where I feel we should insert the audio, in fact, maybe we will, of the great interaction in A Man for All Seasons about giving the devil the benefit of law for our own safety's sake.
Arrest him.
For what?
He's dangerous.
For libel. He's a spy.
Father, that man's bad.
There's no law against that.
There is God's law.
Then God can arrest him.
While you talk, he's gone.
And go he should if he were the devil himself until he broke the law.
So, now you'd give the devil benefit of law.
Yes, what would you do? Cut a great road through the law to get after the devil?
Yes. I'd cut down every law in England to do that.
Oh? And when the last law was down and the devil turned round on you, where would you hide, Roper, the laws all being flat? This country is planted thick with laws from coast to coast, man's laws, not God's. And if you cut them down, and you're just the man to do it, do you really think you could stand upright in the winds that would blow then? Yes, I'd give the devil benefit of law for my own safety's sake.
But nonetheless, you talked about Josh Hammer in your piece, and in connection to the German jurist, political theorist, and National Socialist Carl Schmitt. Could you, Dan, explain for our listeners, if they don't know, who Carl Schmitt is and how his view on politics connects here?
So Carl Schmitt was, you know, a German legal theorist, National Socialist, wrote sort of in defense of the National Socialist regimes in leading sort of academic sort of law publications. And this idea of politics is essentially being reduced down to what he called the friend-enemy distinction is exactly what's being recapitulated here. And it's very dangerous. Part of what it is to live in a community, to live in a society, is to realize that there are civic bonds, that there's a way in which you need to equally regard everyone's human dignity and respect everyone's rights. And when you start to view a segment of the polity as enemies and to treat them as such in the political process, it can have devastating and tragic consequences, as Schmitt's own legacy in Germany shows. Carl Schmitt was someone who refused to go through the denazification process after the conclusion of the war and never really repudiated any of these ideas. He's someone who sort of continues. The fact that this legacy is reemerging is something that I find very, very disturbing in our contemporary politics.
Let's keep in mind that Carl Schmitt was also the foremost legal author and defender of Adolf Hitler's decision in 1934 to decapitate through what clearly illegal means the leadership of what was called the SR, which was the militia of the National Socialist Party. And Hitler declared himself effectively acting ultra vires, effectively outside the law, because this was necessary, he said. And Carl Schmitt penned the foremost legal opinion defending what Hitler had done. And this was a sign that the National Socialist regime was clearly not going to be like any other German regime, that it was going to behave in this particular way and follow this Führer principle all the way through in terms of how it understood Germany as a political entity and how it understood the law. And Dan's right. I mean, he never repudiated his essentially authoritarian conception of politics. It's not a coincidence. He spent some time after the Second World War living in Franco's Spain, where he would give lectures about his particular theory of politics. And I find it interesting that there are scholars on the quote-unquote New Right in America who are either subtly or even directly citing him as a reference point for why they understand and why they believe the political right should act in the way that Dan is describing. And it's very disturbing. It's very disturbing because this, frankly, is how authoritarians on the left think about things. And when this authoritarianism comes from the right, those of us who believe in a free society should be equally condemnatory of that as well.
I think you're absolutely right that this is one of the things that drives me up a wall about all of this, is that it is the political right We can go back to my conversation that I had last week on Act in Line with Matt Continetti about his book on the history of the right, that there is something bizarre about this moment, that some of these new right characters, and we have seen this before, again, throughout the history of the political right in America, pulling in concepts into conservatism that are very European. And that there is a marked difference between American conservatism and European conservatism and what it is trying to conserve. The only understanding I can really embrace of American conservatism is that it is what is trying to conserve is the American founding, which is a different conception of politics and the law than you would be trying to conserve on a more European understanding. So it seems to be that the right is basically in internalizing the logic of the people that they believe are their enemies, and they're operating according to that logic. And I find it incredibly disturbing and in a way un-American, in that this is not the way I think that we are supposed to operate our politics. And that brings on, you know, cries of embracing just a loser version of how this is all, you know, a loser version of conservatism or politics or whatever. I do not think that is the case. Because at some point you have to ask the question of what are we trying to achieve here? And if it is just pure power politics against the people that we don't like, I think that's a road to misery and the road to basically the end of the American political experiment.
Well, of course, if you adopt the logic of enemies and friends, at some point the rule of law will go out the door, because one of the points of rule of law is this equal treatment of all people, regardless of particular things about them. That's the core, one of the core things of rule of law. It's a demand of reason that we treat like cases alike. And when you start to go down the logic of friends and enemies, at some point you'll say, well, they're my enemy, therefore I'm not going to treat them in this particular way, which means that you are effectively departing from basic principles of rule of law, which is essential for any civilization worthy of the name.
This past weekend, Acton hosted a co-sponsored Acton Liberty Fund colloquium on social justice. And one of the interesting things that came up in the conversation there was how going through these issues, talking about many of these controversial issues related to social justice, a lot of people don't feel safe to say what they believe because they believe that will cast them in a light of an enemy, that it will get them excluded from conversations about the common good, and that their opinions won't be valued and respected. And part of what living in a society is, particularly a democratic society, involves granting that tolerance to others and letting us deliberate together about what makes the good society. Because without that deliberation, you cannot have. It's necessary for justice in a society, as Sam was describing, from the legal principles, but it's also necessary to have a broader sort of social justice in society where people don't have to fear being made enemies like this, being excluded, being marginalized. We talk about censorship on Twitter. This is the way that many on the right feel now. And one of the reasons is because certain people have made them enemies, have tried to exclude their voices, have tried to devalue and dismiss their perspectives. And it's this really schizophrenic moment right now on the right, where on the one hand, you have some calling for, you know, rewarding friends and punishing enemies, while you have some of the same people decrying what they think is unfair and disparate treatment in terms of free speech.
As Yuval Levin says, our politics is supposed to be a vehicle through which we achieve accommodations. And treating it in this friend-enemy dichotomy is not the kind of environment in which your politics can lead to accommodations. And part of my problem here, again, acknowledging as I did, that the knock-on effects of this, even if it gets overturned by a court of law, that it may cow companies like Disney into a neutrality in all of this may be the outcome, and it may be a good thing. But the problem with this approach, which is effectively to argue that the ends justify the means, I think after a while the means become ends in themselves. Especially if you're viewing it through this, well, it's me, the hero, and my friends against these enemies, you're just less interested in the justice of the means if it's just a group of enemies that you'd like to punish. I think we should move on to our final topic, which is some COVID-related policy. One here in the United States is we kind of watch last week, I kind of shocked on a Tuesday night as it looked like the mask mandate, the for transportation mask mandate, just crumbled away overnight. And by Wednesday morning, airports, airlines, buses, trains no longer required masks. This is all because of a judicial opinion by a judge in Tampa, Florida. Again, Florida, the center of all of this. That ruled it unconstitutional on two grounds. One, that they had violated the Administrative Procedures Act, the Biden administration in enacting this. Again, fun trivia question. You may think we've been living with this mask mandate forever. It actually, the rule for it was promulgated in February of 2021. That's how long it's actually been around. But ruling that they violated the Administrative Procedures Act, that they didn't engage in notice and comment before making the rule. The judge also ruled that the administration lacked the statutory authority to be able to enact this. I think that led to the inevitable appeal that was filed against all of this. Sam, are you amazed that this all, in any way, that this crumbled away so incredibly quickly? I'm just reminded of, I think it's a T.S. Eliot's line about going bankrupt, that it all happens very slow and then all of a sudden. But it certainly seemed on Tuesday night into Wednesday like it was an all of a sudden. The minute that there was a window for these airlines, for airports to get out of enforcing this mandate, they certainly took it up.
Yes. In fact, I traveled just before the mandate was lifted and just after the mandate was lifted on airplanes. And the change was actually quite remarkable. But I think it reflected something which we all know, which is that the American public, even in deep blue states, is more or less fed up with the masks. They are much more skeptical now of CDC claims, for better or for worse, about the effectiveness or otherwise of masks in preventing the spread of COVID. And it also reflects, I think, a willingness to accept that now we're in the position where we're going to live with COVID just like we live with any other number of infectious diseases. So there'll be particular cities and states, I suspect, that at different points will reimpose mask mandates. I think it was it Philadelphia last week that imposed it and then imposed it back on, then took it back off. I mean, when I was walking around the airport very early on Wednesday morning, and you know, overwhelmingly, 90% of people were not wearing masks, but the people who were wearing them, I thought to myself, well, I suspect some of them are people who have either had COVID and had a very hard time with it, and or people who have underlying conditions and have deep concerns about the possibility of catching this thing. And also people, the third group of people, I think, were people who are essentially ideologically committed to this and believe that we should be wearing these things forever. So that last group, I understand the first group, two groups. It's completely understandable why they would want to continue doing this. The third group, it's just a sign of the deep ideologicalization of something that really should not be part of the whole ideological game. And I also thought to myself, well, the Biden administration now has a get out of jail card, right? Because now they can say, well, we wanted to keep it in place, but the courts made us lift it. So that's one thing. But the Biden administration, as I understand, is going to appeal. So they put themselves back in jail, so to speak. The third thing I will say about this is I noticed that Dr. Fauci made a comment about how he thought it was problematic for a court of law to make a ruling on this particular subject, for which he got rightly pilloried in the sense that it was pointed out to him that administrative agencies, which is all the CDC is, it's just an arm of the administrative state, It, like any other arm of the administrative state, is subject to due process and rule of law and the legislature and the judiciary. And that's something I think a good number of people who work in that particular world needed to hear.
I think Sam is right, and the why they are appealing this is kind of an interesting trap that they have landed themselves in. But I think the way that it ends up playing out is more or less along the lines that Sam just articulated there, that the benefit to the Biden administration here is that they can say that it was a Trump-appointed judge down in Florida who was the one who overturned this. They're appealing it, but they didn't ask for the ruling to be stayed. They could have immediately asked for the ruling to be stayed because they get a little bit of the best of both worlds here, where they get out of a very unpopular mandate and to the very passionate people that Sam pointed out that are in that third group that are the ones who are going to harangue them about the Biden administration, about the mask mandate going away. They could say it was a Trump judge who did it. I mean, what can we do? It turns out differently if that judge only rules on the Administrative Procedures Act part of this. And from legal experts that I've read, the part where she's claiming that they don't have the statutory authority to do this without getting deep into the legal reasoning is at least more suspect and likely to be overturned, which is why they had to appeal this, because they want to claim that in an emergency circumstance, they do have the authority to do it. And what they will say when that is inevitably decided is that on May 3rd, the mandate was supposed to expire anyway. We would have let it expire and we all go on with our lives. And I think that group three that Sam referenced, they do exist. And I think they're a lot like the people we talked about earlier who are going to log off of Twitter for a week or two and then they're going to be back on. And that's going to be their protest against Elon Musk taking an ownership stake. I think a lot of those people, not all of them, but a lot of them are going to very forcefully wear their N95 masks for a week or two. And then they're going to stop doing it when they realize that nobody really cares.
It's been very interesting to see. You'll notice it I noticed it in the post office. This is the first time in a long time that I had seen postal employees without masks.
It really underscores, too, with the airline employees, where if you saw the videos that were circulating, the flight attendants seem to be more overjoyed than any of the passengers because they've been wearing these things for 2 years. Like, I don't know if you saw the one of the guy dancing down the aisle singing, "Put your masks in the trash." I mean, it was something to behold. It is – sorry to interrupt you, Dan, but it is this weird thing that is going on right now where it's these things that are popular – people in positions of power can't bring themselves to embrace things that are popular, like getting rid of this mandate. And it surprises me and it doesn't, I guess.
It's very odd. I mean, you look at it in terms of the private sector. There are businesses that I know that patronize that still ask their customers to wear a mask, but they are very few. And I'm sure that there is some reason in terms of, you know, having, you know, employees that have particular conditions or ownership having particular conditions or just
liability questions
like and that's fine. I mean, none of this is to disparage anyone who has legitimate concerns and would like to, you know, you can wear a mask if you want to.
That was always allowed.
This was always allowed. This was never what the mandates were about. And this is about how to move forward as a society in the wake of a pandemic that is, as Sam said, you know, something we're going to have to live with. This is now an endemic disease.
This has been revealing of the kinds of people who, when something isn't mandated, they seem to be convinced that it is now prohibited, that they can't do it. Just because we're not mandating everyone do it doesn't mean that no one can do it. You're still welcome to make those decisions for yourselves. To check in on how another approach to all of this is going, the attempt to reach COVID zero, Dan, what is happening in Shanghai?
These are lockdowns on a massive scale. And if you look, you know, probably the most illuminating thing from the outside world that you can see is all of the freighters outside of Shanghai right now that are unable to load and unload because Shanghai is locked down. I have seen reports about folks facing food shortages because there are only so many people in their apartment building that are allowed to leave so many times a day to bring in food for everyone. And they're having to don these sort of hazmat suits to go out and go to the grocery store. You've seen some recordings get out of, in fact, public protests of people, you know, and this is, you know, you saw resistance in Hong Kong to many sort of many of the measures of the Chinese Communist Party leading up to their dissolving, essentially, Hong Kong's special status. But you don't see this as often on the mainland. And the fact that you're seeing people confronting police, sometimes even with violence, is something that says that there's something deeply and profoundly wrong. Now, one of the reasons that the pandemic in China has not abated is partially because the Chinese vaccine's efficacy is largely believed to be not as efficacious as those developed in other parts of the world. And
I believe perceived to be less efficacious than even the Russian version.
Yeah.
Which is pretty bad.
Low bar.
And there is, and because the regime is what it is, it's insulated from public criticism. It is insulated itself from any sort of accountability to ordinary people. And it is, in fact, not only lying to the public consistently about COVID in the country, but it is also lying to itself. I mean, there are all sorts of perverse incentives that get set up in authoritarian regimes to make yourself look good to your superiors. So you are more likely to exaggerate your success, minimize your failures, and it results in states acting blindly to catastrophic consequences, not only for the folks in Shanghai and for China, but Shanghai is a major port, and we continue to face supply chain issues all over the world, and this exacerbates those as well and literally affects people around the globe.
Sam, will people be able to connect more with what the actual nature of the Chinese regime is like over these stories of the Shanghai lockdowns over COVID, more so than people up till this point have been able to connect with what the nature of the Chinese regime is like through the story of the imprisonment of the Uyghurs, which seems largely forgotten. But sure, what's happening in Shanghai and with regard to COVID policy does seem to have more salience with people.
Well, I'd like to think so, although I guess my reservation is that if we look at the situation of Uyghur Muslims, which is, I think, is clearly a type of genocide that's being attempted by the regime against them, or the way that Christians and other people of profound faith are being treated in mainland China, it's interesting, isn't it? These things barely get mentioned today. I'd like to think that the lockdowns, the mass lockdowns and the protests that it has produced in some Chinese cities, which of course are very quickly suppressed, would alert more people to what the regime in Beijing really is like. I think most people now have a pretty good sense, a much better sense than they did, say, 5, 6, 7 years ago about what the regime in Beijing is really like, particularly under Xi Jinping and the way he's taken the Chinese economy and the Chinese government, the directions in which he has pushed China, are clearly really just reinforcing this, what is, of course, a 5,000-year-old tradition of centralized authoritarianism. But whether it's going to have any significant impact in the way that we treat China, I think it just adds to a broader picture, which hopefully will become more and more apparent to people. Now, if these the resulting supply chain issues start to directly affect people's bottom line, then maybe it will have some sort of impact. But I do think that there's much more awareness now of what the regime in Beijing is like. We're much less naive in saying that, okay, if you open your borders to trade, this will inevitably lead you in the direction of other forms of freedom. Well, it's clearly not true, and some of us have contested that argument for quite a while. So I think maybe more awareness, maybe more consciousness of the whole thing. Whether it produces any significant change, I'm skeptical.
Between these stories of what is happening with COVID policy by the Chinese government in Shanghai and the Russian invasion of Ukraine, you may find yourself asking the question, who's the person that has been hardest hit by these two news stories developing? And I have the answer to that. The person hardest hit by it is the inestimable columnist for the New York Times, Thomas L. Friedman. The title of his column, recent column on some of these trends being China and Russia giving authoritarianism a bad name.
Let's also remember that he's one of these people that in the 1990s and 2000s was telling us that economic liberalization inevitably leads to wider forms of freedom. Well, Adam Smith never believed that, and neither did most of the Scottish Enlightenment thinkers to whom we owe so much of the case for free markets and free societies. So it's a good reminder that it is interesting that he was saying those things before, and now he's talking about this in terms of, well, authoritarianism. He seems to be implying, at least the headline seems to be implied, that there are good forms of authoritarianism.
This is a rough wake-up call, I'm sure, for the guy who for so long dreamed about the ability to be China for a day. So sorry it's not working out as well for him.
My favorite Thomas Friedman quote sort of outlines his approach. He said that the first rule of holes is when you're in one, stop digging. When you're in three, bring a lot of shovels. And Thomas Friedman is in many holes, and he continues to dig.
You could have convinced me easily that that was a quote from Jack Handy and not actually from Thomas Friedman. But I think we will call it a wrap there. I want to thank you for listening to Act and Unwind today, and remind you that if you're listening to this podcast on our website, scroll down and look in the show notes for the episode where you're going to find a link for where you can subscribe directly to Act and Unwind, or you can just search Act and Unwind on your favorite podcast app. Also, again, please rate and review us on Apple Podcasts, 5-star reviews only, so you can help more people find this show. Thanks to Sam. Thanks to Dan. For the Acton Institute, this is Eric Cohn. We'll see you next week.